In this video, I'm going to walk you through the encoding of an existing critical edition and turn it into a digital scholarly edition. The material I've provided it consists in two scanned pages of an existing edition of a Latin text, a sermon by James of Vitry, a medieval author. You can look at these pages, which are named James of Vitry 101 and 102.jpg, and make sure you understand very well what's happening on these pages, how the variants are represented, what the footnotes mean, etc., etc. Once you've made sure that you understand the printed page, we can move to the encoding, digital version of these pages. So you can open the file James of Vitry exercise.xml that I've prepared for you. This is the page and we're going to have a look at it. So first I've prepared a little minimal TI header with basic title, the name of the person responsible for creating this edition in the first place, and a responsibility statement explaining that this file was encoded by, and here you can type your name. Then we have a section that's called Source Desk, and it's extremely important here. In this section, we have a list of witnesses, list with element here, containing several witness elements. So in this list of witnesses, we are going to list all the witnesses that you're using to establish your edition. Each witness element contains the description of one of those witnesses. Each witness element also has an XML ID attribute with a unique value. And you see that I've chosen to use the same sigla as in the print edition to represent these values. You can also see that I've chosen to just give the shelf mark of the manuscripts and their folio numbers. There could be a much more sophisticated, much more exhaustive representation of each manuscript, but that's not the purpose of this exercise here. So the key point is that each witness has an XML ID that is unique, and we're going to use this, the value of this attribute, to link variants to the witnesses. Now, this was for the minimalistic TI header, and now let's move to the body. In the body, basically, I've just pasted the text so you don't have to type it again, and added some minimal structure, the paragraphs, that is just that. So now it's up to us to start encoding the file and start adding variants to this critical text. So the first variant is actually on the first word of the text, on the serbo. If you check the original edition, you can see that in manuscript P3, you have the word exaltatio instead of serbo as this first word. So we are going to encode that. First, we select the word on which the variant happens. We select sermo, and there's a little trick. If you want to wrap a word or several words into a tag, you can select this word of or words and type Control E. Then you just type the tag you want to wrap them into. Here it's app, and enter. And here we go. You also see that when I do that, I have an angry red square here. That means this file is not valid anymore. Why is that? It's because you can't have text just within app right there. It has to be wrapped into either lamb or reading, for instance. So it means that it's just a temporary state. And if you add lamb here, now you have the happy green square again. The file is valid. So we have encoded the lemma. Now we're adding the reading. If I type a space just before the closing bracket of the opening tag, you see that I'm offered a list of all the possible attributes of reading, and I'm going to choose the wit attribute, wit for witness. And you see that I'm automatically offered the list of the possible values for these witnesses. which are taken, as you can see, from the list we've established here. So in this case, I just want P3, okay? And the last thing to do is to type the actual word that replaces servo. So here we go. Now you see that the line has been a bit pushed to the right because I've added tags and so on. If I want to have a better formatting, I can click on this button here, Format and Indent, which, you know, makes the file more readable. So now I'm going to proceed to the next variant. It's on this word, on alias. So Control-E, app, Control-E, lem. I start typing and here we go, RDG, a space. I choose the width attribute, and this time it's G that has this variant, and instead of alias, there's add. Okay, let's continue. Now we have a variant on the words capitulo quinto, that means chapter 5. And we're told that this is an omission. That is, capitulo quinto is omitted in manuscripts G, P1, and T. So in G, P1, and T, instead of capitulo quinto, there's nothing. So that's how we are going to write that. RDG, space, width. So we have three times the same reading here, but we are not going to repeat the reading tag three times. Instead, we are going to have three sigla separated with spaces in the width attribute. So that is G, a space, P1, and T. And here we leave nothing, we leave a blank, because there is nothing in these manuscripts, okay? And you can see that if I click on Format and Indent now, there's a slight modification of the way this reading, this empty reading, is represented. It was like this just before. If I click on Format and Indent again, you see that it's turned into an empty tag. Do not pay attention to that. It's just a matter of representing the same phenomenon. It doesn't matter at all. So next variant is on this word. That's manuscript G, which has this word instead of sufferentia. Let's continue. So now it's the word was. Which is omitted in manuscript G. So we just leave it like that. Then we have a variant on this word, fornace. And in the print edition, you see that that's just a hyphen with GEM. What does it mean? It means that in manuscript T, the word fornace is actually fornacem. But the obsession of editors in print is to save space in the notes. So instead of writing the full word fornacem, they just wrote the ending, but that's not what we do with the digital edition. We write the full word from that. Now then, next variant, the book of the Bible here, Parables, has been replaced with another book of the Bible in some manuscripts, Ecclesiastico. That's in manuscripts, so G, space, and P3. Let's format again. Next variant, we have the word purificantur. Which is in manuscript P3, purgantur. Then we have the chapter number of this biblical reference, which is omitted in four manuscripts. So RDG, WIT, and we choose the four relevant manuscripts, G, P1, P3, and T. Let's continue. Now, the words sic et here. Are replaced with the word sicut in manuscript P3. And with that, we've just finished encoding all the variants of the first page of this edition. So now we are going to continue a little bit with the second page. The first variant on the second page is actually something I used in some videos, you might remember that example. So the word leniantur is replaced in manuscript R2 with laniantur. All right. Then the word corporalis, which is here, is replaced with the word temporalis in manuscript G. And now, then, we reach a very interesting point. On the printed page, you are told that from line 15 to 17, from the word tantum to the word suavitatis, there is an omission in G. So that means here that from this word to here, G has an omission. So let's encode this variant. All right. And the reading of G is nothing. It's an omission. But now look at the next variant. You're told that on line 15, 16 of the printed page, the word podest is replaced by podere in manuscript R2. And where is this word podest? It's here. It is within the lemma of the variant we've just encoded, the omission in G. Is it a problem? Not at all. You are perfectly allowed to nest variants one within another. So here we are just going to encode the variant on protest as any other variant. So control E, app, control E, lem, and now I add the reading. So it's R2 and prodere. And you see that they are perfectly nested and the file is perfectly valid. Now, I suggest that you continue encoding the rest of the variants on this page by yourself and then check your encoding against the example I provide of the fully encoded file for this edition. I wish you good luck and a lot of fun finishing this exercise.